In the video today, we're answering a viewer question because Jamie G asks us, how does your body know when you need more oxygen? The body has a respiratory center in the brain located in an area known as the medulla oblongata and the pons regions. They get voluntary information, like about when you want to sing or hold your breath, from an area of the brain called the cerebrum. On the other hand, involuntary information from an area located in the hypothalamus affects the respiratory center when you get anxious and/or fearful. Both of these regions affect breathing from within the brain and do not require information from the body, like, say, how much carbon dioxide is in the blood. As for when you're just going along breathing normally without thought, the respiratory center gets information from what are known as chemoreceptors. These receptors are responsible for regulating our breathing, so just the right amount of oxygen gets in and the right amount of carbon dioxide gets out, despite what we voluntarily want to do. There are two main types of chemoreceptors, peripheral and central. They're made up of a grouping of cells called glomus cells. While the purpose of these receptors is to make sure we are getting enough oxygen, most of them don't react to oxygen levels. Instead, most and all of your central chemoreceptors react to carbon dioxide and pH levels. Only peripheral chemoreceptors use oxygen levels as part of how they regulate certain types of breathing. So why and how do these chemoreceptors do it? Almost everything in the human body needs to be maintained in a very narrow range for the many chemical processes within it to work properly. This is known as homeostasis. Every living cell in our body has numerous chemical reactions taking place to sustain life as we know it. The molecules responsible for these chemical reactions are known as enzymes. They control everything from food digestion, the making of new cells, to creating DNA strands. Most of these enzymes are made of protein molecules and all are extremely sensitive to changes in many things like pH, oxygen, and carbon dioxide levels, as well as temperature changes, just to name a few. If you increase or decrease any of these things beyond what is normal for them, different enzymes will begin to react differently, and abnormal processes that cause a wide range of problems begin. As an example, if you were to breathe faster than you need to for the work your body is doing at the time, like with an anxiety attack, you could cause what is known as respiratory alkalosis. The end result might be numbness and tingling in your fingers, toes, and lips, uncontrolled cramping known as carpal spasm, abnormal cardiac rhythms, and low blood pressures. Central and peripheral chemoreceptors all work similarly to maintain the narrow range of carbon dioxide to oxygen levels. Inside of our blood and the cerebrospinal fluid around our brains, there is also a specific amount of oxygen and carbon dioxide. That information causes a reaction that releases different types of neurotransmitters, the chemicals that transmit signals from one nerve to the next to be released. Those transmitters make the nerves controlling our breathing muscles increase or decrease their activity. The end result is faster or slower breathing, depending on the needs of your body at the time. The peripheral chemoreceptors are called that because they are located outside of the central nervous system. They are in two separate locations, in your carotid arteries, known as your carotid body, and in the arch of your aorta, known as the aortic body. When the oxygen levels within the blood get too low, not very much oxygen is forced into the glomus cells. When this happens, the low amount of oxygen causes a signal called depolarization to release the neurotransmitters, telling your nerves that control the breathing muscles to contract. This isn't the only way your peripheral chemoreceptors work. The glomus cells also release carbon dioxide as a result of them working. When the level of carbon dioxide inside the blood gets too high, the CO2 from within the cell cannot get out. This also causes a release of neurotransmitters and you breathe more. More CO2 also causes the blood to become more acidic. This low pH is also sensed by the cells, and thus pH will also affect the neurotransmitter release. In the end, the peripheral chemoreceptors can make you breathe faster or slower by sensing the levels of oxygen, carbon dioxide, and pH within the blood. Central chemoreceptors are located right near the respiratory center within the brain. These chemoreceptors only react to levels of CO2 and pH within the fluid around the brain called cerebrospinal fluid. They affect CO2 and pH levels slower than peripheral chemoreceptors because it takes time for the carbon dioxide to get from your blood into your cerebral spinal fluid through a grouping of tissues called the blood-brain barrier. That being said, it is these receptors that mainly stimulate inspiration and consequently expiration. Expiration causes excess CO2 to be released, thereby decreasing the amount of CO2 compared to oxygen. The result is that perfect homeostasis that we talked about earlier. When it comes to what is most important in affecting involuntary breathing, you can see that CO2 levels tend to affect breathing much more than oxygen levels. It is the only level the central chemoreceptors are aware of, and the peripheral chemoreceptors use it in conjunction with oxygen to determine how they will react. And now for a bonus fact. Speaking of carbon dioxide levels, it turns out female mosquitoes identify you as a potential target for a blood meal, and yes, only the females are bloodsuckers, via the carbon dioxide your body puts out, which they detect via their maxillary palp organ. In fact, mosquitoes can detect you this way from up to about 100 to 150 feet, that's 40 meters away. This is one of the many reasons why mosquitoes tend to target people who are in the middle of exercising more. When you're working out and breathing hard, you're giving off more carbon dioxide than you otherwise would in your resting state. This also contributes to overweight or otherwise larger individuals being more targeted by mosquitoes than their slimmer or shorter brethren. The greater the body mass, the more oxygen the body needs to maintain it, and the more carbon dioxide the individual will give off. Further, the higher your metabolic rate, the more carbon dioxide you give off, and the more you'll be attractive to female mosquitoes looking for some blood so they can make more baby mosquitoes. This is also one of the reasons why children are less likely to be bitten by mosquitoes than adults, and men more likely to be bitten than women. Another contributing factor to people exercising being more likely to be bitten is body heat. The higher your body heat, the more likely a mosquito is to notice you. On that note, this is also a reason pregnant women are more attractive to mosquitoes, statistically speaking, almost twice as likely to be bitten than the rest of the general populace. Pregnant women exhale an average of about 21% more carbon dioxide than when they are not pregnant. Their body temperature is also typically slightly higher than non-pregnant individuals, particularly around the belly. So that's the initial attraction. Much like when clubbing, just because an individual is attractive to you from afar, though, once they get close up, they may actually decide not to go any further. You're just not their type. Seriously, it turns out the factors involved in whether a mosquito will decide to land and then whether they decide to bite you essentially come down to your general scent and taste, both in terms of certain chemicals attracting the mosquito even more and others potentially repelling them. How sweaty you are at a given moment and what exactly is in your sweat will greatly influence these attractive and repellent factors, with such markers as lactic acid, uric acid, and ammonia being among the compounds in your sweat and other skin excretions that attract mosquitoes. On the other hand, those who naturally excrete the compound G-methyl-5-heptan-2-1 have been found to be significantly less likely to be bitten, owing to this compound acting as something of a mosquito repellent. One's blood type also seems to be one of the markers used by mosquitoes to determine whether or not you're a good candidate for a blood meal. How? Approximately 85% of people emit certain blood type markers, something at least certain types of mosquitoes seem to be able to detect. For example, in one study, Asian tiger mosquitoes preferred people with type O blood nearly twice as much as people with type A blood. It also appears that the blend of microbes living on your body also affects how attractive you are to at least certain types of mosquitoes, although research into this is also pretty scant at this stage. That said, in one 2011 study, Composition of Human Skin Microbiota Affects Attractiveness to Malaria Mosquitoes, they found that more diverse colonies of microbes on your skin actually seems to repel mosquitoes, whereas a high density of just a small number of certain microbes seems to attract them. So I really hope you found that video interesting. If you did, please do hit that thumbs up button below, and don't forget to subscribe. Brand new videos just like this every day of the week. For more from me, why not check out another channel I do called Geographics. It's a geography-based channel. I'm going to link to that below. And as always, thank you for watching.